Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Mario Vaggi Gymnasium at Saniel Webster College. For tonight's game on Nashua ETV, it's women's college basketball. Rivier against Saniel Webster. I'm John Collins along with Tom King, our cameraman Tim O'Neill, as we get set for intra-city rivalry basketball. It's Rivier with a record of 2-2. Saniel Webster, which is starting off the season with 6 straight home games, a record of 0-3, their 4th straight home game. Tom, they've struggled a little bit, even on their home court, have the Eagles.
Well, the Eagles are kind of small, John. They've got really only one really solid post player, Desiree McGee, so teams are able to kind of beat them down low, but also they're hurt. They've got some players hurt. Now, if you're looking for players to watch in this game, for Saniel Webster, very quietly over the last 4 years, Ashley England, number 10. There you see her right in the middle of your screen in the white jersey. She is a phenomenal player. She's averaging just over 17 points a game, just under 18 a game. Rivier's Savannah Butterfield, who just won that tip, and the person with the ball, Caitlin Perry from Nashua. Those are the three players to watch in this game. The rest are very good complementary players on both teams, so keep an eye out for what everyone can do in this basketball game.
Caitlin Perry slicing through the lane, looking for the game's first points, draws a foul. As you can see, 30-second shot clocks in women's college basketball.
Yes, let's get into time. I don't want to interrupt you before we go any further. Used to be 35, down to 30 now, okay? Now, the other thing is, in women's college basketball this year, at all divisions, from what I understand, but especially this division, it's not 2 20-minute halves anymore. It's 4 10-minute quarters.
Oh, they went to quarters.
That's
right.
They went to quarters. So we will have a break after 10 minutes, a quick break after 10 minutes. There's Riv with the easy layup, and that's the first basket of the ballgame.
Rebecca DiBaldo of Pelham, New Hampshire, lays it off the glass and in. And it is the Raiders of Rivier who are up first, 2-0 in this one on Saniel Webster's home court.
But yeah, that's going to be a little bit of an adjustment to get used to, I think, the way coaches use their timeouts, because they're going to get an extra one and a half now in each half. So there's all sorts of different ways you have to manage the game as that shot's way off by the Eagles.
Well, not surprising that Ashley England took the shot, but it is surprising how much she missed by. A fine shooter for the Eagles. Rivier on the fast break, leave the layup short. And with the ball is Amanda Darkey of Melbourne, Florida. At 5'2", number 14. Amanda Gendron, number 3. And clashing in the paint, England runs into an Eagle.
And Butterfield, England.
Savannah Butterfield.
Goes into Butterfield, but Butterfield gets called for the foul. I think Butterfield thought she probably was planted. She didn't argue it too much, but she probably felt that she had position. But
so many basketball calls come down to that, you know, subjective decision by the official. Were they planted? Did they get there in time?
And Butterfield was leaning a little bit, so the answer was probably no. Paul Williams, the head coach, there, the tall man in the suit and tie, jacket and tie, and for Rivier, and Andrea Woodbury down in the corner there, not in the corner, but right next to the official. She is the head coach of Saniel Webster College. This is her third season. Paul Williams has been a coach the last 6 or 7 years, I believe.
Off the glass, and it doesn't go for Desiree McGee, but Desiree expected to go to the line. They called her for the foul, it appeared. Or was it out of bounds off of the Eagles? In any case, Daniel Webster has not yet scored in
called,
this one.
I believe she got called for a personal foul. Yep.
It was on
yes.
her.
Yep.
Coming down court, Desiree, cross-court pass to England. She's able to corral it.
Well, England almost dribbled it out of bounds.
Almost a set shot there. Brianna Diggs has it partially
blocked. I don't think they want Diggs shooting from the outside. Daniel Webster's had to deal with a couple of injuries. Once they get a couple of players back, they're going to be a much more formidable team from all parts of the floor. But right now, they're kind of limited, and they've got to play a quick game, quick pull-up jumper type game.
Caitlin Perry flings it to Butterfield down deep, but she hit the side of the backboard. Perry launches from well beyond the arc. That misses, and both teams off to some sluggish shooting here early in this one.
Yeah, you said it right away, John. They're right off to the cold start. Just not in sync at all.
It's November 24, 2015, as we record this on Nashua TV. John Collins with Tom King. Tim O'Neill behind the lens. We're just 39 hours away from the Turkey Bowl live telecast on Thursday morning. I don't know if the viewers are going to see this before that, Tom. Perhaps not. But happy Thanksgiving to everybody. This game actually recorded before Thanksgiving, two nights before.
It's an annual event now on their schedule. They seem to have locked into this Tuesday night game
before Thanksgiving.
It's been this way the last 4 years.
And that high arcing shot looked good out of the hand of Caitlin Bulger, but it also did not go, and it's still just a 2-0 lead.
There's England, nice crossover dribble and a good pass.
Long shot from the corner. That would have given the lead to the Eagles. And they had the Dargie long on the three.
If I'm England, I go in for the shot there. She had all the momentum in the world, and she kind of pulled up and then passed to the corner. I want my best player taking the shots right now, especially when we're cold. Even when she's cold, I want to get her on track unless she can find someone underneath, and that's Ashley England. And there's a turnover by the Raiders as they have not only had problems shooting the ball, they've also turned the ball over a couple times down here.
Jen Thorpe up top. And actually, that was Ashley England who passed it to Gendron. Her shot doesn't go. And down court come the Raiders. Long cross court pass.
Nice passing by Rivier right there. Oh, and a layup miss. But boy, you can tell that they have practiced together for a few days because they had that passing underneath. You don't get that kind of pinpoint passing without spending some time together in practice. But Paul Williams told me last week that they've only practiced, believe it or not, a handful of times with the entire team because they got a few players from field hockey and soccer that came to play on the women's basketball team.
Multi-sport athletes, late arrivals, boosting the quality of
play. Oh, nice rebound. Wow, no one there.
Kaylee Kakavas, who's from Drakett, with some great court awareness there, penetrating in the lane, getting to the ball first, and the freshman from Drakett lays it in.
Yeah, I was just going to say, for a freshman to be that heads up is pretty good.
Errant pass ends up in the Rivier Raiders' hands. Trying to add to their 4-0 lead as they come down court. Caitlin Bulger, number four, hands it off, actually playing some catch with Kaylee Kakavas. Kakavas is wide open from three-point land, not able to get it to go, and England rebound.
The Raiders are doing everything right. Finding the open person, getting decent open looks at the basket, just not putting it in the basket. They can't get the ball to fall.
They swing it over to Ashley England. And the bounce pass off the fingertips of Brianna Diggs, not able to corral it down deep.
And that's where they want Diggs, though. They want her down low. And she got in there, but just couldn't hold on to it.
My pregame notes, Tom, come from a very informative game preview that was written by our own Tom King.
This always scares me when you...
Well, it's from your article.
When you do game prep, I don't care.
I did my game prep.
I don't care.
No?
When you do game prep, it always scares me.
It's not accurate?
Your interpretation may not be accurate.
Well, you pointed out that Hudson native Deanna Purcell has graduated from Rivier this past June.
Right.
The leading scorer in Rivier men's or women's basketball history.
Yes, she is the
just
number one
year
scorer.
Removed from her. So yep. That's the good news for Daniel Webster because they don't have to go up against Deanna Purcell this year. For the first time in 4 years, right?
I've got to say something. And I haven't made this comment in print yet, but I may write it eventually. I don't think Rivier should be in the Great Northeast Athletic Conference anymore. It's a conference that they helped start with Daniel Webster. Daniel Webster pulled out, and they helped form the NECC. But you think about it. Butterfield's a very good basketball player, right? Caitlin Perry, she's really come a long way in 2 years for Riv. But they had Purcell with those players, and they still could not get in 2 years with Purcell as an upperclassman. Actually, I don't think it hit her 4 years.
Yeah.
They could not get to a GNAC final.
That's very telling, isn't it?
It is. And it, you know, it's there's a great
Butterfield,
shot by Butterfield.
Smooth as silk.
Oh,
jumper,
yeah.
Actually a set shot from the left corner.
Yeah, with the left hand. She looked like Jamal Wilkes on that,
yeah,
didn't she? Yep. A lot of people are saying, who's that?
Smooth as silk, Jamal
but,
Wilkes.
But don't you think
Lakers.
That, I just think that that is a very, now it's great that the conference is really tough. And it's very competitive. And if there's no easy wins. But you want to at least have a shot, you know? And they've gotten knocked out by St. Joe's up in Maine a couple of times. Playing that game on the road. They just, to me, it just seems like Riv, and you know, they have one of the best players in the conference. And could not get to a final with him. And that's not on Paul Williams. He's, you know, he's done a great job as their head coach. He brought her on the campus.
Nice steal by Kaylee Kakavas again, showing her court awareness. The freshman from Drake had stepping in the way of that bounce pass and stole it, setting up her team for an opportunity.
Yeah, Butterfield with an air ball.
Yeah.
Butterfield's a very, very determined player who gets down on herself in no time at all. Not, I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean, she gets mad at herself.
Yeah.
So.
Well, maybe she has a favorite or a optimum spot on the court to shoot from. Maybe that's not it.
I don't know.
She looked
she's
good from the left corner.
Smart player. She sure looked good. I think, you know, yeah, if she's in her game, she can hit that shot.
From anywhere?
From anywhere. I think you want her. John, they don't have a 6 foot player, a 6'2", 6'3" center. They don't have a big post-up player. And they don't have, and they don't seem to have that scorer like Purcell was. So you need to be able to hit from anywhere on the floor. You know what I mean?
Right. Escarlin Reynoso, who hit her two free throws earlier, took an extra step there, got called for a travel. So it's Raiders ball on the runner. Doesn't go for Caitlin Bulger, but looks like Caitlin will go to the line as she was in the act of shooting when she got fouled. Caitlin is a junior guard from Quincy, Massachusetts.
Now, I will contrast what I said about Riv and the GNAC, and I'll make my case a little bit even further. I really don't like this. I'll make my case even further. Of these two schools, these two programs, right, which has gone to the NCAA tournament?
Well, I would think because the Deanna Purcell is the all-time leading scorer for 4 years, that it would be Rivier.
But you're wrong. Daniel Webster went to the NCAA tournament a few years ago.
Wow.
And, in fact, if I'm not mistaken, I believe they made it twice.
Nice steal.
But I'm not positive. Maybe only once.
Stepping up and then playing some catching off the glass.
Oh,
nearly
see,
the highlight reel play of the game.
And they cannot buy a basket right now.
No. That was great teamwork there between.
And there's Ashley.
Look at that. England comes back. She averages 18 points a game. It was only a matter of time statistically before she got on track. Launching a three in rhythm, but it doesn't go.
But see, that's my point, you know, and there was another year where they would have probably made it to the NCAAs, but they had a transcript issue that was a technicality that they had to turn in themselves into the NCAA, and they ended up forfeiting some games.
Reynoso looking off the defender as if she was going to pass, and then the contact, and it is a defensive foul against Butterfield. I believe that's her second foul. Reynoso draws it. Aggressive penetration down the lane.
Yeah, Reynoso is a very active player. She's got a lot of quickness. Some of that quickness goes against her when she gets she fouls people. But she's not a bad basketball player, and she's feisty and fiery. And I think that they like having her on the floor. Recruited out of I believe the Lawrence, Mass area.
Correct, Lawrence Tech. And there's another Lawrence player on the team. Natasha Santana, also a sophomore. Mm-hmm. She went to Central Catholic, though. They both reside or grew up in Lawrence. And Reynoso, pretty good at that free throw line. Reynoso makes the ball. So Rivier coming down court now. Here in the first quarter of play at the Mario Vaggi Gym. Mario was former mayor of Nashua back, I think, in the 60s. So he was the one that greeted John Kennedy when he came to Nashua in the 1960 presidential campaign. Yeah,
the Vagy Jim.
And, you know, November 24, Tom, the 4th, 1960, the fourth of the Nixon-Kennedy debates took place on this date 55 years ago. And there was a great basketball feat that took place 55 years ago today, November 24, 1960. And I'll tell you what it was.
I made 10 free throws in a row. Is that it?
No.
Oh, well.
Were you with us in 1960?
Yes, I was around.
Oh, well, yeah.
Oh, sure.
You were an infant, though.
John, I was around in 1860.
England's thought about it.
Nice
and she drives. And it won't fall.
Oh! England, I'll tell you what she did there. There's a basket.
What a great feat underneath.
And the
excellent play by
the
Eagles.
They grabbed the lead, 9-7.
That was Mackenzie Stone, who's just 5'1". Plays guard and forward. She went to Notre Dame High School in Connecticut, Shelton, Connecticut.
There's a lot of Notre Dames in terms of high schools. There's one
in
Tingsboro, too.
Notre Dame Academy in Tingsboro.
Yes. Yep.
Correct. Right. And that was her rebound. She fed the pass up top, and the Eagles get a basket out of it. So,
I'll tell you, you got to give Andrea Woodbury credit. She's not just, you know, settled for winning people down the street. You know, she's gone out and tried to get people from wherever she can.
Andrea Woodbury in her fourth year as the head coach of Daniel Webster College.
John, I covered Andrea Woodbury when she was the head coach at Londonderry High School back in the early to mid 1980s.
Clearly, Lindsay Roth took a step before she got going, and she did go to the, well, we talked about Tingsboro. She went to Tingsboro High. Lindsay Roth, number 12 for the Raiders, is a freshman. Tingsboro, what's their school nickname? It eludes me for a moment.
Yeah. I don't know. I used to come to the years
They used
ago.
To play Alvern in the Turkey Bowl
Turkey
game,
Bowl,
didn't
yeah,
they?
Yes, they did. A lot of Thanksgiving football that was played but is no longer played.
Right.
Merrimack and said he can no longer play.
There's long a buzzer shot, beat, yep. And it doesn't go.
And there's the effect of the quarterly play.
Right.
You know, because yeah. We would be at, you know, halfway through the half. But that's the end of the first quarter, as you see, thanks to the camera work of Tim O'Neill, 9-7 in favor of the Daniel Webster College Eagles.
Great start for the Eagles. They're 0-3. They've got six straight home games to begin the season, so they want to get on the winning in the winning column.
That's not bad, huh? Six straight.
Yeah.
Home. Yeah, no.
It's nice, but they started out this game trailing. It was at least 4-0, if not more, and they come back and they take the lead after one quarter of play, 9-7. The Eagles outplaying Rivier for the good last 5 minutes of that first quarter to take the lead.
Well, Rivs started the year off 0-2, losing two games against tough competition in the UMass Dartmouth tournament, or Fairfield Inn tournament, hosted by UMass Dartmouth. They lost to Westfield State, and then they lost to UMass Dartmouth. But their last three wins, or their last two wins, okay, at Fitchburg State and against Plymouth State in a Boys and Girls Club Classic up in Concord, two wins. So those are pretty good established programs that Riv has beaten. So not a bad turnaround as they are gunning for their third win in a row, all non-conference. I don't believe they start conference play until after the new year, January the 5th.
That's Tom King. I'm John Collins. Tim O'Neill manning the camera here on Nashua TV as we begin the second quarter of play. Daniel Webster with the ball and the lead up 9-7 as they work it around
nice
the perimeter.
Move.
Excellent
nice
move.
Move.
The Eagles, Amanda Dargy.
Well, what happened there? Everybody collapses on England as she takes a step to the basket. The threesome converge in the zone, and that leaves Dargy open from the corner. And there's a shot that wasn't falling in the first quarter, falling now for the Raiders from three-point land.
Caitlin Bulger with the long-range shot. So it is a 11-10 game right now. Turnaround in the paint. Brianna Diggs left it short.
Diggs having a tough game to start. Losing the ball underneath a couple of times and taking some jumpers from a little bit outside her range.
Jen Thorpe handling the ball now. Early second quarter. Daniel Webster up by a point, 11-10 on their home court here against Rivier. Rivier in the navy blue uniforms, and of course Daniel Webster in the bright white and red trim. Baseline, running out of room was Perry. And down court comes the Eagles. Is that a foul?
Yes, it is. Yep.
That was Haley Barnard.
Tried a little bit of a half-court trap, but there was too much movement on defense. Yeah.
Haley Barnard, who missed that layup, hit the bottom of the backboard. She's the tallest player on the court at 6 feet out of Bedford, number 22 for the Raiders. She's out there.
And she was a
and she just blocked that one.
Shot changer right there.
Yeah. Interesting. Every, especially the smaller courts, have their own character. In the men's games, we often see guys do running fast breaks, and they go down the hallway after they finish because you go past that. That comes up really fast.
Now that hall, right, that yeah. Right on the right side of your screen, that's the entrance to the gym. Now, the hallway on the left side, when we go down the other way, that leads to the trainer's room and a couple of locker rooms. But out in that lobby, there's a, off that lobby is a fitness area.
Right.
You know, yeah. So they've got a lot of stuff here.
In a small space.
In a small space is right.
They fling the ball back and forth, playing some catch. Caitlin Bulger. And picking it up off the ground was Jen Thorpe. Shot made by Lindsay Roth doesn't go. There's that hallway Tom was talking about.
Right.
Down to the trainer's room and coach's offices.
Coaches' offices have been moved out of this building for the most part.
Yeah.
They are now in one of the townhouses, taking a spot on two floors.
Cross-court pass.
So there's a referee's dressing area, there's another locker room off that hallway, and the trainer's room, which is probably one of the most important rooms on campus. If you're a student or a coach,
right,
you know, make sure they know where that trainer's room is.
Gendron misses the runner, but Desiree McGee is right there for the rebound, and she will shoot a couple. Desiree at the line hits it. 55 years ago today, Tom, November 24, 1960, Wilt Chamberlain, 55 rebounds in a game against the Celtics, a game that Wilt's team lost to the Celtics, 139-129, but 55 rebounds, and that record stands today.
Wilt Chamberlain just made so many individual accomplishments as a player. His team is just...
And you know, we all know about the 100 points, right?
Right. He just could not quite do it. Now, they won a couple championships, but Wilt is the type of player you would have thought would have won a lot more. Instead, that honor went to Bill Russell. So.
Right.
There's a kick, and the Raiders get away with one there.
Nice steal. Heads up play. Having a great game is Desiree McGee. And one of the reasons why Daniel Webster has the advantage in this one. Trying to clear out a little bit here. Ashley England wants to turn it into the A&E network. But
they are in charge.
The defense stepped up. England's going to go right. Penetrates. Runner. Good.
There's Ashley England. You know why she is such a good player. The best player in this program. Out of, Old Town, Maine. She's from Maine. I know that. Danny Rose has had a lot of good athletes from Maine over the years.
Brianna Diggs stole it, but then had her pocket picked as Lindsay Roth was coming up court.
Yeah, the pass was tapped away, so there's a jumper.
Thorpe hits it.
Yep.
Jen Thorpe got open.
Big bucket.
England starts and stops. Gendron goes cross court, ends up in the corner.
Nice bounce pass into England.
By Diggs, and England hits.
Yeah, and now you see the versatility that England has in this offense. She can drive to the basket, she can shoot from the outside. Here's a steal.
Desiree McGee again. Down court, switches direction, stops, pops. What a terrific play.
And boy, Daniel Webster opening it up. They've got a seven-point lead right now.
Long shot. Looks good. Is good.
That's cut down now.
Lindsay Roth, the freshman from Tingsboro, shows her shooting ability. England's got it. She's going to penetrate in the lane. Splits the defense off the glass. No foul. Good, but she is fouled.
But see the play, two plays earlier, where they posted her up. So she's got that ability to do it either way. Just has to pick her spots. She can weave her way through the middle.
Ashley England is from Old Town, Maine.
Right, I was right. Old Town, Maine. That's what I thought. Gets the freebie.
You know, you mentioned Bill Russell about, you know, the championships and all that. Interesting, when Chamberlain set that record of 55 rebounds 55 years ago today, he broke the existing rebounding record of 51 set by Bill Russell 7 months earlier in the previous season. Yeah, he had 51 rebounds in a game. That's tremendous.
He also had
dominance.
Better players, Russell, did around him than Chamberlain.
That's the key.
For a while. Right? It's clearly a team game. Michael Jordan struggled for a few years.
Putting up 60 points against the Celtics, getting
to the finals, or getting at least to the semis.
He needed Scottie Pippen. They made a change.
They got Scottie Pippen, but they still weren't winning, and they made a change. They got Doug Collins out, and they brought in Phil Jackson. Phil Jackson.
The Zen Master
eventually is credited with taking the Bulls to that next level. Before he took the Laker job.
I did a little reading on Wilt Chamberlain. He was known as Wilt the Stilt, and apparently he detested that nickname.
You got a lot of time on your hands.
I just thought it was so remarkable that we were doing a game 55 years ago to the date where a guy had 55 rebounds,
right. No, I think that is remarkable. But here's the thing. If you want to know a little bit more about Chamberlain and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, HBO, I believe it was HBO, did a special.
A good-looking shot doesn't fall.
On Abdul-Jabbar and his life and his relationship, including in that, was his relationship with Chamberlain.
I saw a piece of that documentary. I didn't see the Chamberlain part.
Which was teacher, pupil, and then adversary.
Ooh.
You know, rivals.
Yeah.
So once they, Jabbar, as a time, you know,
entered the NBA.
Yeah. So there's Paul Williams, the head coach of the Rivier Raiders.
That's another thing that Tom just mentioned you're going to have to Google, youngsters, is Kareem Abdul-Jabbar's original name was
Lou Alcindor.
Just kind of like Cassius Clay became Muhammad Ali.
Correct. There's a nice block.
Beautiful block.
Yep.
Underneath, I believe that was Barnard again. She's got three blocks in the game.
Rivier needs some offensive consistency. They need go-to people. To kind of take, someone's got to take control of this game the way Ashley England did for Danny Webster. Could it be Butterfield?
Oh, another silky move off the glass.
Certainly with a move like that, she could do it. Nice move there. And the Raiders are back to within three.
Clock has it, the scoreboard has it 20-18, Tom, in favor of Daniel Webster.
Oh, so 1 point off.
What? Yep.
No
air ball, no good. So Daniel Webster coming into this one at 0-3, have hopes of getting in the win column at the expense of their intra-city rival Rivier, who are 2-2 to begin the season. Rivier with 17-18 point per game score, and Caitlin Perry, who really hasn't asserted herself yet. And that one is good. Was that Caitlin, or was that somebody else?
That was Perry.
Yep, it was Kay, yeah, just the right on cue, actually.
That's 5 points for her in this game.
Yep.
She's had a quiet game so far.
She's
Butterfield with a big
from.
Rebound.
Long pass and nice. Oh, they step out of bounds. The red, big red stripe is the out of bounds here.
There's the score, 21-20, 3:59 left to play here in the first half. That is the first half, or actually you could say the second quarter, but 3:59 left to play in the first half. The Raiders on that Caitlin Perry bomb from the outside, have the lead at 21-20. They were down 20-13. They are on an 8-0 run. There's Butterfield. Bang!
Oh, wow. She is in rhythm now.
She sure is.
23-20. Rivier is on top. Long range shot by the 5-1 Mackenzie Stone. She nearly got it to go. You know, I credit Mackenzie Stone for getting in there and playing college basketball. She just traveled, as I talk her up a little bit. But, you know, some kids might just quit. I'm 5'1", college basketball is not for me. You know, she, obviously she has the skills to play at this level, and she's making a go of it. And she even lists herself as a forward in the program at 5'1", number 21 for Daniel Webster I'm talking about. There's a set shot from downtown, rattles off the front rim by Emery Nelson.
Now, she doesn't list herself as that. That's where the coach has her.
Okay.
All right? That's, yeah. That's the position the coach wants her to play.
Right.
Because she's
boxing
got the ability.
People out.
She's got the ability to box people out. And, you know, they call them small forwards for a reason, John.
And she gets the rebound on cue and rips
it
away
is.
From everybody.
How about that, huh?
Yep. Mackenzie Stone, good position.
Good position, fighting some knee issues. As you can see, she's got the big brace
yeah.
on her left leg. Oh, nice pass. She's wide open, but had to go down to get the ball. And I think when she came up, her rhythm was off, and she throws it over the basket for an air ball out of bounds. It'll be the Raiders ball.
Yeah, even the best players, Tom, I think they like to launch and create an angle where they can bank it off the glass on a play like that.
No but, question.
Yeah, it's tough to go right to the hoop with the shot. Takes a lot of touch from in close like that. You're often better using the backboard. And that's a foul is going to be called against Daniel Webster. I think it was against Mackenzie Stone. Oh, they called it on Desiree
first
McGee.
Personal,
and we have a timeout.
Timeout Eagles.
Yeah, Eagles, and I think they need a timeout. They need to get their defense set. Their defense, John, is going to have to be huge because once you get Perry and Butterfield untracked, there may be no turning back.
Right.
You're going to have to be able to not let them get in that kind of rhythm.
As we
unfortunately,
go,
that's what's happening.
We go from the Eagles huddle to the Raiders. Tom mentioning the head coach is Paul Williams, the tall gentleman closest to the camera in that shot. Attended Rivier, graduated from Rivier.
And played for the men's team.
Oh, yeah, 2002.
Coached with the men's team as an assistant. So he knows the school in and out. He knows the limitations. He knows the strengths that the school has. There's a nice pass at Butterfield. Who else there for the layup? That's 6 points in the last couple of minutes that she's put up on the board, and the Raiders are off and going, John. Their lead is up to five.
Savannah Butterfield, averaging about 14 points a game, is well on her way to that. A travel by Daniel Webster, ill-timed, as Riv is on kind of a run here.
They sure are. Starting to take control.
Butterfield, long pass, and the hustle of Reynoso gets in the passing lane.
Those are the things that Reynoso can do for you. She's quick. You know, she's got basketball instincts. She's going to be slapping the ball away. She's going to be filling the lanes. She always gets back on defense.
I don't know her story, but I can imagine that she was, her skills were honed in the playgrounds of Lawrence, maybe the YMCA down there.
You've got to think so, but look at the way she hopped. You know, you may be able to hone skills, but the hustle is something you don't teach, and she's got that. You've got to have a player who wants to do it.
True.
She definitely wants to hustle.
She's hit most, if not all, of her free throws in this game.
Correction, that's the fifth Raider foul.
The fifth foul for Rivier, and believe on five. I'm not sure what the count is for the half. I think it's six.
And as I praise Reynoso's free throw shooting, and they get the rebound.
There's no more one-on-one for this. It's going to be two shots.
Ashley England.
Fouls on the floor will now be two shots.
Double team, kicks it back to Reynoso, makes a nice one-handed catch.
Oh, there's a nice pass for England, setting her up, but Riv does a good job to come over and shut down the lane.
Desiree fighting for it, out of bounds off of Rivier. McGee. Good work on the offensive board.
What the Raiders had to do in that situation was pay attention to the rotation. And when England rotated towards the middle, they had to put someone in the middle right away. So they know when she goes this way, you shadow her. And that's what Riv did in that situation.
Oh, I want to give a shout out to Campbell High School here. Alex Trevanes, I think she just drew an offensive foul, number 44, who is a sophomore from Litchfield, New Hampshire at 5'10". She's inbounding the ball right there. And a nice defensive play by Trevanes prevents another Daniel Webster score.
Campbell has put a few players in great spots with the local schools.
Butterfield faked the pass, the turnaround from deep. It was a two, but nonetheless impressive by Savannah Butterfield.
God, she's on it. She's got 8 points in this Rivier run.
5'11" out of Londonderry, New Hampshire.
There's a jumper, short. Eagles just can't find a rhythm there. I think one of the problems, John, is that they're getting back on defense, getting frustrated, and they're getting tired. I think that's part of the issue right now with having limited bodies.
Caitlin Bulger shot that ball. She's hit a shot from that.
Yeah, thing. Here's the thing. You got a player like Butterfield who's hot.
Go to her.
Just go to her. Don't try wild, long shots. Go to Butterfield.
Bulger to Butterfield.
Bang.
Bang. Three Bs.
Yeah, how about that, huh?
Yeah.
She is on fire.
She's looking really good. Locked in, as they say. Daniel Webster had the lead in at the end of the first quarter, 9-7. That's a distant memory at the moment as Rivier piling up the points here in the final moments of the first half. Desiree McGee baseline, running out of room. Nice running shot, not able to get it to go, though. Trevanes, bounce pass.
Ooh.
They're throwing the shoulder, and I want to say that probably should have went the other way.
I think it should have went the other way, definitely. Yeah. Perry leaned in.
Eagles
7 seconds, he was in a hurry.
They
too.
Called it against England.
7 seconds left.
Yeah.
So they called on
that
Ashley
England.
That
was not really a difficult call. I mean, that was like a football shoulder. We had the good angle on it from Tim's camera,
right,
too. Subjective calls in the NBA. I mean, in basketball.
This isn't the NBA.
Yeah, I mean, I was going to say, I shouldn't say NBA, but
if
basketball officiating.
If this was the NBA, John, we would have been well fed before the game, right?
What are you throwing Ken Belbin under the bus for not feeding us?
Belbin's not here.
Oh, that's right.
No, hockey game.
Oh, yeah.
We got the head honcho.
Problem. At least we could have got
M&M's. The AD is in charge tonight. Belbin, who's he's the sports information director for Daniel Webster College, also the
England's going to shoot this.
Also the assistant athletic director, but he is running the hockey game tonight.
She drew the foul. Oh, travel!
Ouch!
So now it's the Raiders that have 2 seconds to get a shot away. And they want Savannah Butterfield to go down the court and possibly shoot this thing. Haley Barnard inbounds it, and they're not going to get the shot away. They kind of needed a touchdown pass there.
They did, but down 21, 20-13 at one point, Rivier has rallied with an 18-1 run, and they lead it here at halftime, 31-21 over their city rivals, Daniel Webster College.
Well, it's a tale of two quarters, Tom. They were down 9-7 after one. They put up 24 points in that
second quarter,
and thanks largely to Savannah Butterfield.
Yeah, no doubt about it. I think she had 12 in the quarter, and we saw 10 of them in about a four-minute span.
That's Tom King. I'm John Collins. Nashua ETV coverage of Rivier versus Daniel Webster Women's College Basketball. We'll be back with the exciting second half conclusion right after this break.
Disasters can happen anywhere at any time. When disaster hits home, your family will depend on you. In a disaster, you are the superhero. Be prepared. Sign up for emergency alerts and visit readynh.gov. Take action. Be safe.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Mario Vaggi Gymnasium at Daniel Webster College in Nashua. I'm John Collins, along with Tom King, Nashua ETV's coverage of women's college basketball. It is the fourth game of the season for Daniel Webster, all home games on their home court. They had designs on getting in the win column, at least after the first period of play looked good. They were up 9-7, but then they were promptly outscored 24-12 in a tremendous second quarter by Rivier, which continues.
Well, I'll tell you what.
Caitlin Perry lays it in.
Tremendous second quarter by Savannah Butterfield, who leads all scorers with 12, is the only double-figure scorer in this game right now. Ashley England, as you would imagine, leads Daniel Webster with 8 points. But Butterfield, by far, the top scorer in this basketball game.
Brianna Diggs with a twisting runner in the right lane. Gets her own rebound, but can't get that to go. And down court comes Caitlin Perry.
Here's the other thing, too, John. Daniel Webster's out rebounding in the air, 21-19. So, I mean, that's, you know, at half. They just got one in. There's Butterfield.
It goes. Does it count? Was it before the shot?
I think before the shot. I think they whistled her on the floor. You don't get continuation in college basketball like you do in the NBA. In the NBA, that's a basket. That counts.
Savannah's listed as having gone to Tilton Prep, Tom, is it? There a prep school up there? Because she's from Londonderry,
New
Hampshire.
She's from Londonderry, but yeah, there was a prep school. Yep.
I guess the Lancers would have loved to have her on
the team. They sure would have. John Fagula was the coach at Londonderry at the time. He's now retired, but he was the head coach there when she was there.
England double-teamed underneath, just moved her pivot foot. And
well, actually, John, she did probably play at Londonderry, and then...
Oh, transferred at
and
the
then,
end?
And then transferred.
Yeah, they probably list just the last school that they were at.
For a couple of years.
Tom mentioned earlier that Caitlin Perry is from Nashua. She played her basketball at South. And her teammate, Emery Nelson.
Gets the look. Goes in and out.
Nashua North.
Yep.
Number 20 for the Raiders. Diggs thought about it. She's going to throw kind of a wild
Diggs
runner.
Diggs got away with the travel.
And Desiree McGee working hard on the offensive board as it deflected out of bounds.
Desiree McGee does work hard, but she's got to be a little bit more forceful. And she's got to, you know, push her way to the basket.
Tried to do it right there.
Right there, and she had no room. So there, what you have to do, take the dribble.
Rebecca DiBaldo guarding her.
Yeah, try to take DiBaldo on the dribble. See if you can dribble around her.
Perry, who's double teamed, and she throws it off of Diggs' leg, I think, out of bounds. So it'll be Raider basketball as Savannah will inbound.
There they are, the two centerpieces of the Riv program. Caitlin Perry, Savannah Butterfield.
Great 1-2 combination. Swatting at the ball, Amanda Gendron, number 3 on defense for Daniel Webster. Holding it. Kaylee Kakavas. Kakavas back right into England. I think she shouldered her in the jaw.
And she got called for the foul. I didn't think they were going to call it on her. I thought they were going to call it the other way because they've been doing a lot of that in this game.
And England is right back on her feet, as tough as Holly Holm. Taking a shot from Ronda Rousey.
I don't pay attention to this.
Oh.
It's all showbiz.
You're out of it, man.
It's all showbiz.
That's where it's at now. Women's fighting.
Fighting, yeah. Man.
Marquee matchups. Big money. Australia.
Is there going to be a rematch?
I think there will be. It hasn't been announced yet, but it's right there on the table. There was a lesson for everybody in that match, too. Ronda Rousey made a couple movies, kind of gone Hollywood, lost her humility a little bit. Holly Holm stayed humble.
Oh, nice play by there's Diggs.
Yes.
Getting the ball where she wants and being able to show her athletic ability with that move as she fades away and hits the basket.
Rivier.
Eagles need more of that.
They certainly do to get back in this game.
Runner. Perry!
Perry with the highlight of the game.
So now you worry about Butterfield.
Yeah.
And she goes off on you. And now you're worried that Perry, who's already got the basket in this half, can do the same thing.
So Caitlin Perry, who finished the first half with 8, averaging 18 a game, you might imagine that it may be her turn to get hot here in the second half. That was certainly a spectacular play, a scoop runner in the lane, but doesn't make the free throw.
Now, Perry didn't have... She have eight? Yes, she did have eight. No, she did not have eight.
Who had eight? Sure. Somebody had eight.
Perry only had five.
Oh, I'm sorry.
There was nobody.
Was it Ashley England that had 8 points?
England had eight, but there was nobody in the first half above Perry other than Butterfield.
Right.
Butterfield just took that second quarter over.
Third on the team.
Rivier inbounds it to Butterfield, always an inviting target at 5'11 and able to leap, holding the ball over her head. Rebecca DiBaldo cross court, and Kaylee Kakavas passed it into the corner. We have a foul before the shot.
Underneath, and it goes against the Eagles, and they wonder why.
Vivencia Philippe is from Miami, Florida, number five for Daniel Webster in the game.
I'm sorry. These people that are coming up here from Florida?
Yeah, you're wondering why?
We have to save them from themselves. You know, good point. Really.
We basically have to ban them.
Because what? We got to save them from themselves. Stay where it's warm, people.
I'm with you, man. Good weather.
Last year we had a snowstorm on this night.
We did.
You know?
We have snowed. Three players from Florida on the Daniel Webster College Eagles. You got Desiree McGee, prominent player in this game. A freshman just got here from Spring Hill, Florida. There's Amanda Dargy.
Why?
From Melbourne, Florida.
The admissions department in there is going to ban me from the campus.
And
you know?
Vivencia Philippe, who just got from Miami. Also, Addison Vickery, number four freshman, is from Suwanee, Georgia, which holds the heat pretty good still at this time.
Yeah, Andrea Woodbury didn't exactly open up the window and yell out in the backyard, anybody who wants to come play, did she? She did some traveling.
Yes.
She got some players
Brooklyn,
from
New
far
York,
away lands.
Unique Battle. I think you mentioned her in your preview.
Yes. Yep, I did. 35-23, as you see the score there, with thanks to the camera work of Tim O'Neill with 6:27 left. You know, John, Tim's got to aim that way all the time for the board because there's nothing on the other side. You need another scoreboard.
Yeah, they do.
Either that or they should get a Jumbotron and hang it down from the top. What do you think?
Just a little one.
What do you think?
Just have a little score in it?
Just a little Jumbotron hanging down?
Yeah.
Wouldn't that be good?
Well, I mean, maybe they can get one in the Black Friday sale at Walmart along with everybody
else.
I was just going to say.
Yeah, no kidding. I'm not going near any place.
No way.
Huh?
That's craziness.
Oh, yeah. No, thank you.
As we record this, we're about 38 hours away from the Turkey Bowl live on Nashua ETV. Chances are you won't see this game before that. But happy Thanksgiving to everybody. Very nice looking free throw there by Caitlin Bulger, who hits one of two. And Rivier still comfortably in the lead as Daniel Webster tries to get on a run here. McGee underneath, backing in. Try to find Diggs, got the ball back.
Yeah, she just couldn't get herself set to try to put the ball up again, which is what I would have thought she would try to do. And now Rivier's defense collapses in the corners very well, and they're doing their best job to try to prevent any posting up down low by McGee, because they know McGee can be very effective there. It's a good defensive job by the Raiders. That's something that the Eagles have got to figure out a way to counteract, and I believe they're going to bring a couple players into the game to try to do just that. A little bit more quickness, maybe.
Key defensive play made there by Rebecca DiBaldo, number 21, who was in the paint, got a hand on it, and that led to the turnover. So DiBaldo, who's congratulating Kaylee Kakavas on that free throw, contributing to the Rivier effort here. Rivier trying to go 3-2 on the season as they entered this one.
And Reynoso back in the game.
Oh, yeah. Number 13. Hitting her free throws was Kakavas. And down court comes Escarlin Reynoso.
Now, see, if the Eagles were deeper.
Call her Essie. Yes. Yes.
We're a deeper team. I almost thought of Escargot. When the Eagles have the ball with the guards that they have, what would work for them ideally is an up-tempo game. Okay?
Yep.
They're not able to play that right now because they don't have enough bodies.
Oh, look at that. That's just incredible.
Should
twisting.
Be against the law right there.
Yeah.
Caitlin Perry. Oh, my goodness. But see, that's the thing is they can't run. And that's what a player like Reynoso would just thrive on. But they don't have the stamina there.
Butterfield. Nice.
They don't have the stamina and the ability to run shuttle people in and out because they've only got 10 players. They need those extra bodies.
Ashley England off a pick. Bounce pass, goes to the basket, gets the return pass from McGee, gets fouled.
Again, they post up England down inside the baseline area. They post her right up.
I believe it's Butterfield's third.
Yep.
No.
No, it's Perry's third.
Perry's third.
Yes. Oh. So she is out of the game now. Let's see if the Eagles can take advantage of that. Or is she out of the game? No, she's still there.
Yeah.
13, she's still in it.
She doesn't want to get another one, though.
No, you can tell. She's keeping her distance a little bit.
Right.
That hurts you, though, sometimes.
Perry gets the return pass.
See, John, if she didn't have three fouls, she would have taken that to the hoop.
You're probably right.
You know,
Reynoso on a two-on-one to McGee gets fouled. Can't get it quite up over the rim and in, but will go to the line. Desiree McGee.
The Raiders tried to play defense in the paint.
Congratulations to a young man you've written a lot about, Tom. Daniel Webster College men's basketball player Ryan Gauthier passed the 1,000-point plateau.
1,000 points.
This past weekend, scoring 17 against Roger Williams.
I don't think he passed it. He was right there.
Right on it?
Right on it.
Oh, that's interesting.
Right on it. Exactly on it.
He needed 17. He got 17.
He got 17.
Gauthier's in his senior season already, Tom. Seems just like yesterday when he was throwing up dramatic game winners.
Seems like yesterday when he was throwing game winners for Nashua North.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. And games we covered and very exciting Nashua TV games. Apparently, it was 4 years ago.
Time flies.
It does.
Fun, John.
Yeah. Caitlin Perry's having fun at the expense of Daniel Webster. You can go to Reynoso getting down and playing some defense.
Tell you what, Ryan.
Digging in.
Tell you this about Ryan Gauthier. He had a big game.
Philippe, that was sorry.
He had a big game in that Midnight Madness game a year ago. And, you know, he's had some personal tragedies. His father passed away and things like that.
Right.
He almost transferred to Riv after Dave Fosher was quit as the Eagle head coach over a dispute with the administration. And Gauthier wanted to quit and talk to the people at Riv, but they said, you're better off where you are. And, you know, but, you know, what you want to do is what you want to do. You're not going to stand in the way of a player. But Gauthier had a chat with the new head coach, who's now in his second year, Donald Morris Jr., and Morris Jr. convinced him to stay. I think Gauthier's glad he did. They've got a good team this year. I think they're going to go places.
Vivencia Philippe had the ball stolen away from her by Caitlin Bulger.
There's a nice move by Perry. Oh, my goodness. That's the spin move.
The third spectacular bank shot that Perry has had in this game. And doing damage on those.
Big Nashville South Fisher was still there?
Yeah.
They've struggled the last couple of years.
Reynoso's high arcing three-point attempt does not go, and the rebound.
Oh, that's a That's a bad
Barnard,
foul.
Barnard, yeah. That's always that frustration. You miss a shot,
you
follow too aggressively.
You miss a shot or just don't get the rebound you think you should get. And Eagles foul boom. At number 21, Mackenzie Stone. Stone gets called for the foul there. And it's a 19-point, actually it's a 21-point lead by Rivier as they have taken that deficit. It's amazing. They took that 20-13 deficit, and all of a sudden they have just taken charge of this basketball game.
November 24, 2015. Happy birthday to the Big O. Oscar Robertson is 77 today, the only player in NBA history to average a triple-double per game for an entire season.
Fabulous player, and basically was the missing piece. If you want to take a look at Kareem Abdul-Jabbar's career.
Runner doesn't go for England. Frustrating.
Jabbar was a great player, just like Chamberlain was. Wasn't it quite the scorer Chamberlain was, but very close to it. But Jabbar never won unless he had a premium point guard with him. First one was Oscar Robertson. The Bucks got him a year after Jabbar was there. And that turned them into a team that was mediocre
Milwaukee
to one
Bucks.
That went 66-16 and won an NBA title. So, and then when he was traded to the Lakers, he didn't make, you know, waves that much in the playoffs.
Until
one Magic Johnson arrived. And there is the big thing about Jabbar's career and the thing with Chamberlain. You know, he had Jerry West, but for some reason, I don't think those teams had the depth to be able to win titles the way that the Jabbar Lakers did.
England with the step back doesn't go. Well put, yeah. Magic and Oscar Robertson.
The two players who complimented Kareem Abdul-Jabbar during his career and brought him his, helped bring him his championships.
Yeah. And you can, I mean, you can see too why some people argue for Oscar Robertson being one of the best players of all time. Because triple-double, that's assists, rebounds, and points.
That was a different game then too. And it was a game that was, you know, where your job was, you're a guard, and your job is get the big man the ball. You know, and if you can score, that's a man of advantage.
Okay, he's stolen inbounds it, and England will walk it up the floor.
Al Singer won his title 70-71 season with Milwaukee. That was his only title with the Bucks. Lost in the finals of 74 against the Celtics. And then he was traded to L.A. A year later.
It's back when Dave Collins was doing battle.
And as a 6'9 center.
Yes. Yeah. Big red.
Eagles take a timeout here, and they need it. And their job right now is just to try to hang around because you get that extra time with the quarters, so you have to take advantage of that.
Andrea Woodbury in the middle of that huddle as some of the players distribute drinks, and we take a look at that scoreboard.
19-point game with just 2 minutes left in the third quarter. It sounds so strange to be saying third quarter in a college basketball game. It really does.
And you pointed out the kind of curious fact that the men chose not to go with the fourth
quarter.
Well,
don't know whether they chose or didn't choose. I don't know how it was legislated, but there is no change in the men's game except for the shot clock. I believe the shot clock is 30 for them as well. So, you know, it's tough.
Rivier up with that great lead that they have. They only have 3 fouls against them as a team, so things are going well for the Raiders. England with it as she crosses midcourt. Daniel Webster was up 9.
What a triple team once England gets the ball. Once England gets the ball down low, they triple team her. You know, and you're going to say, well, that's lack of respect for the other players. No, it's not. What they're trying to do is prevent England from getting the ball to anybody else.
Yes.
You know, not so much stopping from scoring, but make her just basically be on an island. And that time she puts one up no good. She hasn't scored in a while, John.
Diggs underneath. Good bounce pass from England, and she lays it off the glass.
Diggs is finding her niche right now as she got on track to this game as a low post player.
Raiders answer right back as Caitlin Bulger draws the foul underneath. 46-27. A 19-point lead for Rivier.
And really all because of Butterfield at the end of the first half and Perry at the start of the second half. That's where your lead is developed.
Yes.
That's the 1-2 punch that the Raiders have against teams where they're, you know, more or less on average equal to, you know, when you look at everybody involved, you take away those two players, it's pretty equal. You know, maybe giving a slight edge to DW with Ashley England. But then when you throw in Perry and Butterfield, that's the edge right there that the Raiders have.
Butterfield takes a rest. Alex Trevanes, number 44, comes into the game in her place as the Raiders add a couple of points by the way of the free throw line, 48-27, 21. Reynoso, runner in the middle, doesn't go. Down court. Reynoso's huddle hustle comes from
there
behind
it is.
The field.
There's that hustle that Reynoso has. Got to be aware of where she is on the floor at all times, on offense and on defense.
Stone for three.
Too long.
And a offensive foul on Diggs.
Yeah, a loose ball foul on the rebound.
Haley Barnard, the senior from Bedford, had position, and Diggs ran into the back of her.
I believe we're shooting free throws here.
You're right. They're in the penalty.
They're in the penalty early here.
Probably a one and one here. So the
no, there is no more one and one. It's two-shot foul. I believe they may change that rule as well.
Wow.
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, nobody's going out
yep,
that rebound.
It is. It's yep. Two-shot foul. No one and one. And I believe
interesting.
That, I believe that also holds true in the men's to the game as well.
The high school still has it, right? The one and one?
To a point.
Yeah, until you get deeper into the penalty.
When you get your 10th foul, then you're shooting two all the time.
Interesting. So college just jettisons that, huh?
Yeah, they took the one. I think the 101 was at least, you know, any man or women. If it is going to the men's game, that's a big advantage for some teams.
Nice off play. The glass and in. Tingsboro Tigers, it just came to me. I think Tigers.
Yeah, I think you're right. You maybe see a pause.
Yeah. Lindsey Roth, number 12 for Riv, is a Tiger. Long shot and misses to the right. By Emery Nelson of Nashua North. Runner, a scoop shot
yeah,
by England doesn't go.
But I don't blame England there because she's got to, you know, she's got to do. They need points and they need points in a hurry. You
yes.
know, down towards the end of the quarter, there'll be a break. She's still, they need points. They're down to 6 seconds left in the period.
They're counting down the seconds.
And
beautiful
she
job.
She did beat it.
Yes, and you know, the Raiders fans helped out on that. To give the countdown, as Tom pointed out before, the clock is only on one side of the court.
That's right.
And so they heard the countdown.
They heard the countdown, and Perry knew she had to rush. And
as time expires.
Take that shot in a way that we know.
Nothing
that,
but net.
Yeah, the way we know that she beat it was the backboard didn't illuminate until that was done. 50-29 going into the final 10 minutes. Of this basketball game.
And Butterfield really hasn't scored in a while, but she's done sufficient damage to have already won this game, Tom. The probability that Dana Webster's going to rip off 21 points here.
In a quarter is pretty low, but I mean, and shut you out at the same time.
Right.
But they've taken her out, and you wonder, you know, is she going to be done for the night? They're going to give her back, put her back in the fourth quarter. You've got to, your substitution policy now changes a little bit with that quarterly pattern, you know, because I think if there were 10 minutes left in the game that you're up 21, you'd rest Butterfield for a while and then you put her back in a little bit. Now with the quarters, you know, yeah, you might, you know, change the way you use her. She out there now? I can't tell. No, she's not. She's on the bench. Perry is out there. I think that Paul Williams will want one of the two on the floor at all times for his team just to make sure there's not this any kind of a monumental push by the Eagles.
Angelisa Rhodes is out there from Lawrence, number 14 in the navy blue.
And a
almost
half gets,
got a steal there.
Yeah, well, you did get a steal on the other side. You did get a steal by the Eagles. So... they almost gave it back. Then there's a
right.
foul. And that's going to be a blocking
Angelisa
foul.
Rhodes took a hard hit
she
that
She did,
time.
But I think she's getting, is she getting called with the foul? No, she's not. They're going the other way.
She actually had a smile on her face as she got up off the court.
Yeah, she established position. Her second personal foul. Let's see that photographer all comfortable the there lying. I could never do that.
No.
Yeah?
Yeah.
First of all, it would take an act of God to get me up. So... I'd never get comfortable lying down like that.
Cross
somebody's coming, some, you know, players diving at you, what do you do?
Yeah,
you
that's
know?
The thing I wouldn't want to see.
There's a good post-up move by the Raiders.
Great execution.
Trevaines.
Alex Trevaines.
There's your player right there from
Lichfield. Campbell.
Yep.
With the basket. Diggs gets it into the corner. The shot by Dargy doesn't go.
Out of bounds. Eagle ball. Eagle ball. They tried to sell it, they couldn't.
So entering the fourth quarter with a 50-29 lead. Webster adding to it. Rivier adding to it.
It's out here.
Up top, Gendron. England gets it to Diggs. Now up top to Dargy. Thought about the shot, didn't take it. Gendron. Bounce pass, McGee twisting.
She beat a triple team in the middle. That is not easy to do, but she's got the athletic ability, and she's, you know, thin enough, where she wiry enough, where she can kind of maneuver her body around.
A runner.
Get that in.
Rhodes, nice try, doesn't go. England, with one player to beat, kicks it out. The shot from Dargy is short.
She's missed twice from that angle now.
And pushing the pace. Caitlin Perry, she can make those.
That one doesn't go in,
and they let him play.
No foul. Five on four.
England took a hard contact there from Rhodes after
McGee
they let that go.
Rushed that shot. There, she's getting it again. She was fouled. They get away with it.
Diggs, turnaround, off
Bang.
The glass and in.
All right, Diggs is having a good game.
Yeah, that was Barkley-esque.
That was. She is having a very good game after a slow start in the first period.
The Eagles are not giving up.
And you don't see Butterfield coming out. She's not one of those players that's sitting on the sidelines waiting to come in this game.
Inside the turnaround, that's a player we haven't called before, Kayla Davis, who's from Wareham, Mass.
Here's the thing that Williams has got to look at this game. Oh, England.
Pretty.
Driving.
Scooping. Just grazes the glass on the way down through the hoop.
Here's the thing that Williams has got to look at. He wants to get other players involved.
Swish.
He does right there.
That's Trevaines.
Trevaines is playing very well.
England.
You want to get your other players involved. It's a non-conference game. If you lose it, you know, it's not a big deal, except it's a local rival. There's a big shot from the outside.
Amanda Gendron of Mount Vernon played her high school ball at Sauhegan.
Sauhegan, yep.
With her nicest shot of the game.
So you can mix and match here and get some of your other players a lot of playing time.
England in the right spot to get that rebound.
Danny Webster,
reaching
on the other
in
hand,
was Rhodes.
Danny Webster, on the other hand, they're hungry for a win. They want to get the W.
Raiders foul on number 14, Angelisa Rhodes.
Blame them.
Yeah, no, this is what they want.
Maybe they need to go on the road.
Could be.
There have been teams in different sports that have done better on the road, believe it or not, for whatever reason.
Now the Bruins are one of them, right? In the hockey,
yeah.
In the NHL hockey, yeah. There's McGee. They do a lot of posting up with McGee, and there's a whistle that's going to go against the Raiders.
They'll call it against Kayla Davis.
Yeah.
Raiders foul on number 35, Kayla Davis, her first, second on the team.
Up top is England. Just threw a football pass over to Gendron, but that shot doesn't go. Diggs working hot underneath. Great
bounce
pass.
Oh, Diggs! What a play. She is having a great game for the Eagles.
Showing off her ability underneath the basket, making shots, making passes.
Finding the open player, and it's McGee underneath. Diggs, boy, great court awareness, great court vision.
Andrea Woodbury's got to be very happy with how her team has played in the last 5 or 6 minutes here in the fourth quarter. Maybe too little too late. But it's
travel. They got away with it, but there's a turnover anyway.
Diggs poked that loose with the steal. England flings it into the corner. Up top, Diggs wants it.
Nice
great
pass.
Beat to Desiree.
Look at that. Diggs, boy, I'll tell you. What a play.
She's an assist machine right now. With that great court vision, nearly a steal.
Well, not only that, John, a steal.
By Dargy.
You know, she stole the ball down the other end.
Dargy got a piece of that. Desiree gives it to England.
Well, momentum is starting to change here a little.
Daniel Webster on the run. Scoop shot doesn't go. And Desiree McGee crashing over the top gets called.
Yeah, she gets called for the foul.
Hope she's okay.
She's all right.
Holding her lower back a little bit.
Well, athletic move
time
for her.
Out.
They're going to take time. I think that was
Eagles
a good time.
Number 22,
Paul Williams called that.
You know, it's really a shame that Leyen did go for England because they were threatening to make a decent game out of this.
Well, it's decent right now, John.
13?
It's only 13 with 5:39 to play.
I mean, that would have made it
they
11.
They have cut 10 points off that lead.
Yep. Nice run here in the fourth quarter by the Eagles. It's one thing not to give up, but they've just turned the momentum right around here. And thanks in large part to Brianna Diggs, who's from Washington, D.C., by the way, number 33 for the Eagles, played her ball in high school at Friendship Collegiate.
Where nobody's friends with anybody.
Not on the court, anyway.
No, even the players on the team, they all hate each other.
You look in on the huddle with Paul Williams, who's got assistants Ryan Baker and Mike Hollering.
It's not foul trouble that's got Butterfield still on the bench. She's only got one personal foul. Interesting,
decision?
Yeah, decision. Yeah. I mean, I don't know if she's hurt or not, but.
Just wanted to shut it down for the rest of the game.
Get
other people in.
I think that Williams wants to play a lot of other people because he wants to.
He's doing that.
He's got to show confidence in them too.
Yes.
So,
Kaylee Kakavas bounce pass finds its way to Jen Thorpe.
It's a long season, John. I mean, they're going to be playing games all the way through until President's Day, usually. We haven't even hit Thanksgiving Day yet, so
right.
They got some time. They got 3 months here of basketball.
Ashley England directing traffic. Gentrin,
one more outdoor event to do, and then we are indoors for the rest of the foreseeable future.
Unless we get a winter classic along the way.
You know, Eric McCambley, you say that.
Off the glass, no good.
The head coach, the head men's ice hockey coach at Daniel Webster College, he would love to have an outdoor game at Holman Stadium. He would
Holman
love it.
Stadium.
Where else are you going to play one?
Wow, somebody's got to set the rink up.
No kidding. I guess you could do it at
Stadium. There's no outdoor rinks in the nearby geography?
No, you want to do it at a stadium venue where you have more people.
That's true, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So he would love to do that. He mentioned that to me last year. You know, maybe a four team, like a New England type guy, Franklin Pierce, Southern New Hampshire, St. A's and Daniel Webster. He would love to do that. City budget would go through the roof.
Can't do it at Stella's. You mess up the turf.
Think you'd probably mess up the field. Well, I don't know if you would or not.
It depends on what you. Maybe you have to put down a platform. Maybe you mess up the bristles.
I don't know. You know, it's. You can't do that much damage to it. Well, you might with what you're going to use, but they're doing it this year at Gillette in their field turf. So, because that's generally they're doing.
That's right.
It's a field turf facility.
Yeah,
so
that could be the model of how to do it.
It could be, but I doubt you'll ever see that done here. I would be shocked. But then again, I never thought you'd see two schools playing at midnight every year.
Midnight Madness. Minimal setup involved in Midnight Madness.
Just show up at
the right time.
Yeah, you just got to get everybody's alarm clocks working. Just show up at the right time.
Ashley England showing some great hand-eye coordination
trying to cut this thing to 12 if they can.
A runner is good.
Yeah, that hurts right there.
That's a dagger. Kaylee Kakavas of Drake it. Able to nail that one. Left-handed runner goes for Ashley England as they answer right back.
You've even got Perry out of the game right now, I believe.
He does.
He does. So this is it. He's going to go with this group. I don't think they're coming out.
Right.
He's going to have them hold the fort because they've got to play meaningful minutes for him and for Paul Williams, and he wants that to happen.
England in and out.
Imagine if that had gone.
Yeah.
Something tells me if that ball had gone, you would have seen Caitlin Perry in the game fairly quickly.
Foul committed right at midcourt. I believe that will go against Amanda Dargy, whose high school is listed as Florida Air. Two words, Second word, Florida A-I-I. It has intrigued me since I saw it.
Eagles foul line number 14.
Does that mean they teach
third air?
Something about air? They teach how to fly?
It's probably an aeronautics school, I would imagine.
Wow. Right. Nice free throw made by Kakavas, a freshman from Drakett. He'll go by the middies, right? The midshipmen.
I have no idea what Drakett does.
Drakett middies. They graduate in a mock boat in the middle of a high school football field.
They
that's
did.
A tradition.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Walk across the boat and get your
diploma. Well, that's right. You would know because you used to cover
that.
Yeah,
yes. Yes. Cover the Drakett graduation once.
Jeff Moore, the Bishop Gritton High School.
You deliver your graduation speech in the bow of the ship like Leonardo DiCaprio in the Titanic, King of the World. There's a strip steal, but it goes right back to Riv.
It was air ball.
Bounced out of bounds. So it's Daniel Webster's. Mackenzie Stone will do the inbounding to Ashley England to bring it up the court. Happy Thanksgiving to everybody watching Nashua TV. Hope you can also make time to watch the Turkey Bowl, either on recording or live, on November 26th from Stello Stadium, South versus North. Runner by England. Pretty play. Ashley England turns Nashua ETV into the A&E Network for a moment. Up top it goes, around the perimeter. Nice feed inside. Trevanes, though, kind of lost control of the turnaround. Stepping up to make the steal, heads-up play by Jennifer Thorpe to Trevanes. Stepped out of bounds.
Yes, too bad. It was a nice shot by Trevanes.
Yeah, to make it go.
She showed a lot of good athletic ability to kind of weave her way around the baseline, but unfortunately, the foot stepped out of bounds. The Eagle crowd here has come alive. As the team down by 23 at one point has rallied back.
England changes direction, looking to pass it. Darji flings it into the corner. Diggs, who's a good passer.
Oh,
finds
she's
Stone.
Move.
Oh. Try to go skyhook.
She went too far one way. Yeah, exactly. Kind of ran into a defender.
An open three. Misses to the left, as you could see clearly. Kakavas just off. England ran up against a quadruple team, launches just into the game. Jackie Piseko, who is from Chelmsford, got fouled from behind.
Yeah, she got leveled almost. She got hit hard. But she'll go to the line and shoot two.
Eagles foul.
As this game is almost under double digits.
In addition, number 13, Scarlett Reynoso, has been assessed a technical foul.
Yeah, Reynoso,
as the fourth personal foul.
What she did was she got a technical. She missed a shot, got called, and then she took the ball and banged it against the wall.
Okay.
Down to the far end. We missed that. She banged it against the wall, and that was the technical foul call.
And Paul Williams designates Caitlin Bulger to take the technical foul free throw.
Try to put this game away for Rivier, which is letting Daniel Webster hang around. Ooh, in and out. Let's see. I'll have to examine her style.
Yeah, she's lefty, first of all.
Let's see.
I'll have to
see. Well, let's see now. Let's see the knee bend.
Actually, she's shooting equally with both hands.
Yeah, you know what she needs to do is she needs to put her left foot a little bit ahead so her body leans into the travel.
Okay.
Momentum takes it forward.
Yeah.
Instead, she's standing kind of very statuesque, you know? Very still.
Yeah, he almost shoots it with both hands.
Right, with both hands. She needs to go and arc.
Have one hand guide? You're talking about a tremendous overhaul of somebody's free throw.
Yeah, Pasenka's not doing very well either. She's just throwing it up there.
Yeah.
I always wanted to put my foot ahead. Give the ball some directions.
She's almost at the same.
Oh, nice steal by the Raiders. Out of bounds. Looks like I got a couple of possible clients.
Got
for
some
the,
projects to
for the
work
summers
on.
For the school this summer, right?
Yep. Down court comes Amanda Dargy. Looks left, passes right to Gudencia.
They need to shoot. They need to shoot quickly.
And a trip is called against Trevaines.
Did anybody really trip her?
Phantom trip? I didn't see it either. I gotta admit.
I thought she slipped.
I thought she went down on her own. But, you know, there was no objection at all from Alex Trevaines. I don't know if that's just because people from Litchfield are so polite, but she got called for a foul and she didn't object. England's got it. Long shot from
Bang! That's a three. It should be. Yes.
It is a three-point shot. Twisting around to Kavis.
8-point game. Pass. All of a sudden.
Seiko throws it across
this
court.
This game has become a contest.
Now it's Rivier milking the shot clock, which is down 10 for Baines. Double teamed and
out of bounds. Eagle ball. Wow. Excuse me. I'm all choked up about this. This is a very big turn of events. Partly, possibly, because Paul Williams is letting his second and third unit players out there to try to build depth for the season in a non-conference setting.
Philippe with a kind of a wild runner doesn't go. Down comes Rivier and an easy put in for Jackie Pacheco.
Yes, puts it right in.
And now Rivier steals it in the backcourt, calls timeout, and they maintain possession with that timeout.
Yeah, you've got to think that Pacheco's basket, John, is probably the biggest one of the half.
Yeah, and
you know, besides Perry's couple of twisters early.
Coach Williams' strategy of allowing his other players to get meaningful minutes is paying off here in the fourth quarter.
It's definitely paying off.
As we have a break in the action on Nashua ETV's November 24 recording of women's basketball, Eagles of Daniel Webster hosting Rivier at Mario Vaggi Gym. Nice round numbers there, 60-50. Credit the Eagles for making a game of this. A few more shots in their favor, and we could be talking about buzzer beater
time. You also need to credit the Raiders.
Yeah.
For not fouling. Because if they were fouling,
different
Eagles
story.
Different story. Eagles would have chances galore to get back in this game. Because they only have 14 fouls.
England commits the foul. And
that's the sixth for Daniel Webster. They're going to send the Raiders to the line.
Her third personal foul.
Up 10 with just, you know, 20 some odd seconds left to play.
Caitlin Bulger comes to the line.
Well, it looks like Perry's not coming back in. She finishes the game with 15 points. She would be the game-high scorer if things remain the way they are. And Butterfield will finish with 14. She looked like she was on fire to score 14 in 5 minutes for a while.
Offensive rebound for Rivier. Pacheco can't keep it in bounds, though. Brianna Diggs will inbound it for the Eagles.
And this is a big difference in terms of the way the game is being played for Paul Williams and the Raiders, because when they had Purcell and a couple of other players, they were all about offense and getting a lot of points on the board. And they're going to finish this game unless a miracle happens. And that, you know, unless a miracle happens, they're going to finish this game in the low to mid-60s. That's, you know, against a team like Daniel Webster last year, I don't know what the final was, but you could see them putting 70 or 80 points up on the board. Not the case right now.
Pacheco inbounds it.
Good press by the Eagles to try to do something, but the clock is ticking down as the seconds are ticking away. Travel call, it causes a turnover, so it does the job. Just a little too late for Daniel Webster, which did make this a game, but now with 0.8 seconds left to play. And I still don't believe there's any such thing as 0.8 tenths of a second.
Yeah, someone's got to shoot this right away. And she does.
She does. And doesn't get it, but that'll do it. That's the final score, everybody. Rivier University, their third straight win after starting off the year with two losses. They win this one over Daniel Webster, which falls to 0-4. They win it 61-50 in a game that probably you could say wasn't as close as the final score indicated.
That's true. So a 3-2 season so far for Rivier. Good luck to them and also to Daniel Webster as they seek their first win after this game as the schedule continues. Happy Thanksgiving. I'm John Collins for Tom King, our cameraman Tim O'Neill, and our executive producer Pete Johnson. Thank you for watching. The final score for the final time, Rivier 61, Daniel Webster 50. Good night from Daniel Webster College, everybody.